This Week in Startups is brought to you by Walker Corporate Law, a boutique law firm specializing in the representation of entrepreneurs. Visit them at walkercorporatelaw.com. Audible.com, a leading provider of spoken audio information and entertainment. Listen to audiobooks whenever and wherever you want. Visit audible.com/twist for your free audiobook. In today's episode, Jason talks to Tony Hsu, co-founder and CEO of food delivery service DoorDash, about their latest innovations and how he built a successful company in a shaky market and wildly competitive space.
From day one, it was a belief that the score will take care of itself in the long run, right? So build the business correctly, right? Who cares if it, up market, down market, whatever. I mean, the markets are going to change. And frankly, that's not in our control. So let's not worry too much about it. Yes, we obviously are impacted by it, but let's not, you know, obsess over it. Let's instead obsess over our customers. Let's obsess over, you know, things within our control and do those things right.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to This Week in Startups. I'm your host, Jason Calacanis, and this is the program where we talk to founders and investors about startup companies, building stuff, making companies that put a dent in the universe, and it's hard work. And sometimes you get lucky, most times you fail. 7, 8, 9 out of 10 startups that get funded here in Silicon Valley wind up being a donut, which, by the way, is a zero, return zero capital. It's hard what we do. And sometimes you have an idea and it's really easy to get started because it's a hot sector. And then it gets really hard. That's one of the things we're seeing right now in Silicon Valley with the on-demand economy. Everybody said, wow, Uber's doing so well, Lyft doing pretty good. Not as good, Uber's doing a lot better. But anyway, putting that aside, everybody rushed in and said, hey, on-demand, delivery, this is a huge space, we should apply it to everything. And then you saw on-demand house cleaning failed, on-demand dry cleaning, on-demand valet parking of your car failed. Maybe the dry cleaning thing did work, I don't know. But one of the things that was so obvious that 100 people rushed into it was on-demand food, right? It makes sense. What are the things we do all the time? We move from point A to point B, that's Uber. And we have to get food, we have to sustain ourselves. People do that a couple times a day too. Well, Tony Hsu is with us and he is the founder, co-founder and CEO of DoorDash. And DoorDash has been a beneficiary of this hugely hot space, but now things have gotten real. And a lot of, there's been a huge washout. Spoon Rocket, a lot of these places have been having a hard time with this concept of unit economics. So let's talk a little bit about what is DoorDash. Give us a view of where it's at in terms of scale, because it's gotten really big. But then let's get right to this issue of unit economics and does the business work or not? Because I know that people were saying, this can't work. You know, Instacart, people were really thinking Instacart's not going to make it. It's too low margin. Food's too low of a margin. Address both of those in either order you prefer. And welcome to the program.
Thanks, Jason. Well, it's great to be here.
Finally here, yes.
I know, right? I think we saw each other in LA last, so it's nice to see that you're up here. So DoorDash is an app and a website where customers can order delivery from over 20,000 restaurants. We're live in 24 markets across North America, including Toronto and Vancouver in Canada. We launched actually our 24th market just a week ago in Columbus, Ohio. We're headquartered here in San Francisco. We have over 200 people. It's been a really fun ride for us over the 2.5 years you mentioned.
Yeah.
I think, you know, the interesting thing about on-demand and you know, this particular point you're talking about is it never was easy. And I think the thing that has changed, you know, maybe since, you know, 10, 15, 20 years ago, even when some of these ideas were tried before, is just the unprecedented level of demand, actually, that really has, you know, I would say made the economics as well as the operations possible. Mm. I think sometimes people don't give companies like Webvan enough credit of how close they were actually in making it work.
Yeah.
I think that's one of the parts of the story that's less told.
Did you study Webvan? Because that was a Sequoia-backed company.
Absolutely.
Actually, and they spent hundreds of millions of dollars, and I believe they actually built their own facilities.
Actually, we share three investors with Webvan: John Doerr, Andy Ratcliffe, and Sequoia Capital. Michael Moritz, Andy Ratcliffe, as well as John Doerr served on the boards of Webvan. So it was a pretty phenomenal team assembled to build that business. Yeah, you're right. They had warehouses all across the country And, you know, in at least from my assessment, maybe it's a minority point of view, but it was that it was a lack of demand that ultimately caused them not to work. Mm. There, as much as people loved Webvan, there still wasn't enough people at the time shopping online. And over the past 15 years, thanks to the likes of Amazon and many other companies, buying things, you know, over, you know, the internet, whether it's your, you know, tablet device, your mobile device, or your laptop, is, you know, pretty common.
Yeah, I mean, there was a point in time when Webvan was out that majority of people were concerned about putting their credit card in the internet.
Yes.
The idea of typing your credit card into the internet was like, whoa.
Yes.
Now people are like, oh yeah, you want my credit card? Take a picture. Here's a picture of the front and the back. Take it. Do what you want with it.
Well, now you just put your thumbprint on, right? And all of a sudden you can just pay with your fingers.
With Apple Pay. Right? So when you went to Sequoia with this idea, you went through Y Combinator, and when Sequoia looked at it, and Alfred Lin's on your board, did they look at it and say like, they instantly got it because of Webvan and instantly wanted to do it? Or did you have to walk them through this like unit economics issue and why this would be profitable and why now? Because that is a big question that Sequoia specifically asked, is why now?
Yes. So
what was your answer to that question?
Well, I think a couple of things. I think one on the demand component, but two on the supply side, you know, for the on-demand economy and the companies in this space, you know, ourselves included, obviously, the smartphone offers us supply, actually, not so much demand. And what it really offers us is the ability to tap into a workforce that wants flexible work opportunities, right?
Actually do the deliveries.
Yeah, in the past, for example, if you wanted to do something like that, you might fax someone your schedule. So, you know, I drove for Domino's for a couple of weeks before, you know, starting DoorDash. Actually, I drove for various delivery services, you know, Domino's, FedEx, and a few others. We can talk about that. But literally how you would literally write your schedule is, you know, you write your name, your check-in, check-out time on a sheet of paper, and, you know, your boss would call you, right? That is the traditional labor economy for how deliveries were facilitated across a wide variety of companies. And the smartphone really allows the on-demand companies to, you know, access a pool of workers that were very difficult to assemble in the past.
Yeah, they're people who are students or they have other pursuits in life. They could be stay-at-home moms, stay-at-home dads. They want to work for 2 or 3 hours while their kid's at school.
Exactly.
And then they want to go pick up their kids and have a quality of life and maybe put in 20 hours a week. They might be the second income in a house.
Exactly.
So their $500 a month or $1,000 a month actually pays the mortgage or the car payment or the tuition. And they're not the primary breadwinner, but it's an important part of the bread coming in.
Totally. And that's why, you know, they really value flexibility in their hours, right? And so I think that was a big component. And you know, when it comes to any business, unit economics has to be one of the first things you think about. In fact, you know, when we started the company, it actually had nothing really to do with the hotness, you know, to quote you, of the sector, right? I mean, for us, it was actually a want to help small businesses. Mm. It wasn't actually to do with delivery or with food. Yeah. Part of the story is personal. So my mom's been a small business owner her entire life. She still runs her third business,
which is
a medical clinic, actually, in the Bay Area. And, you know, we didn't even find out, my co-founders and I didn't even find out about the topic for delivery until we spoke with small business retailers. Mm-hmm. Some of them sold food, most of them didn't, but they all shared this challenge of fulfilling deliveries, which to me is a very strange phenomenon because delivery is not novel.
Yeah, it's been going on forever. But the idea of having to have a delivery person on staff and having to build your own app, I mean, this is where it gets priced out. I mean, you're negative already out of the gate if you just hire somebody to do deliveries.
Yeah, I think, and that's actually one of the things you learn when you drive for a place like Domino's. You always have too many or too few drivers, right? And you never get it right. Even Domino's, who does over 1 million deliveries a day in the U.S. of pizza.
It's amazing.
It really is. Even, you know, Domino's can't get it right. And it's because a single store can't solve these fluctuations in demand, right? And no one, it's not like any small business owner started their business because they want to become a delivery person, right? They started it because they want to be the best florist or, you know, the best restaurateur, et cetera.
What's the economics of this? You pay the delivery drivers a fee every time they do a delivery, or do they get paid by the hour? How does it work?
Yeah, so for us, consumers pay us a delivery fee. Mm-hmm. That goes to the Dasher. Our fleet of drivers, cyclists, motorcyclists, et cetera. They also keep all the tips.
Got it.
And so, you know, they're netting about $15 to $20 an hour.
Which, if you don't have a college degree and you want to work your own hours instead, it is impossible to find anywhere else.
So we, you know, have found that it's very interesting just what we've seen even in retail, for example. Yeah. So when we started out of Y Combinator, as you mentioned, we noticed that a lot of our Dashers were actually coming to us from Starbucks. And this was a strange phenomenon. It's not like we advertise at Starbucks or anything like this.
Right.
But if you think about the life of a Starbucks barista who starts their, you know, earnings at $10 an hour and they're capped on a certain number of hours they can work in a day, think about what they may need, right? They may not need another full-time job, but to your point, they're looking for a flexible work.
Yeah.
And that's, you know, we were one of the ways they found that.
And this whole settlement, Uber settled, I guess, with California and stuff like that. Have you been looped into all of that? Are people debating if they're independent contractors, if they're delivery people? I mean, it seems pretty clear they're independent contractors. They make their own hours, right? They get tips. They, you know. So have you been dragged into all that, or have you had to settle this kind of stuff, or what's your take on all that?
Yeah, so we're certainly familiar, right, with the settlements. Yeah. Obviously, we're watching the space closely. I'm not a lawyer, so I'm not going to comment on the specific, I guess, you know, claims of the settlement.
Right.
But you know,
it seems like a good thing though that people are saying, hey, the drivers want to be independent contractors.
Yes.
They don't want this forced on them to not be independent contractors, because then they got to show up at a specific hour,
yes,
which they don't want.
Yes, exactly. And I think, you know, the two general points that at least I took away from the settlements were, one, you know, how do we maximize and maintain flexibility for the Dashers? And two, how do we, you know, offer them input into the marketplace? I mean, these are things that, you know, we started from the beginning. In fact, you know, one of the most difficult parts about building a company like DoorDash is that you kind of have to find product market fit with three audiences. It's not just with consumers. It's with our Dashers, also with our merchants.
Yeah, they all have to be in agreement.
Yeah, it's a complicated set of trade-offs you have to make to run this three-sided marketplace.
All right, when we get back, I want to talk about the restaurants and all that, because there was some, was it DoorDash that had the controversy with In-N-Out Burger, and you were delivering In-N-Out Burger, and In-N-Out didn't want you delivering In-N-Out? This is DoorDash, yeah?
This is DoorDash.
All right, when we get back, let's just tackle the hyper-controversial issue of In-N-Out Burgers on This Week in Startups. Hey everybody, let's take a moment to thank my friend Scott Walker from the Walker Corporate Law Group. They are a boutique law firm specializing in the representation of entrepreneurs and startups. And they encourage fixed fees. They believe that billable hours reward inefficiency, so they will give you a fixed fee to form your companies, do merger and acquisitions, licensing agreements, terms of service, privacy policies, all that important stuff that you need to get dialed in perfectly for your startup. And their lawyers have 10 to 20 years of experience each. No junior associates getting on the job training with your startup. No, they're all pros over there. And if you want to talk to the founder, Scott Walker, you can call him directly, 415-979-9998. 415, that's the area code here in San Francisco, 979-9998. Or you can email Scott at walkercorporatelaw.com. Scott at walkercorporatelaw.com or visit walkercorporatelaw.com. Again, call him, 415-979-9998. He is a great guy. He's been around for years, coming to all of our events and supporting everything we do. And he is a real mensch, a great attorney, and he's got a great team over there. A lot of my startups use the Walker Corporate Law Group and have had a great experience. Go ahead and follow at Scott Ed Walker on Twitter too. He loves to get new followers, and it's awesome when you guys thank the partners for supporting independent media like This Week in Startups. Okay, let's get back to this program. Hey everybody, welcome back to This Week in Startups. I'm really excited to have Tony Hsu here. He is the co-founder and CEO of DoorDash, which I use constantly. Awesome. It works.
Thank you.
And DoorDash has done spectacularly. They have Kleiner, Sequoia. They graduated from Y Combinator, Coastal Ventures, just the A-list of A-list in terms of investors, and raised a Series C from Sequoia back in March of this year for $127 million. So obviously something is going fabulous well. The product is awesome. If you haven't tried it, go download DoorDash right now. And let's talk about the specific restaurants, because you have competitors out there, right? There's a competitive landscape that is people who make the food themselves, like, I guess, Sprig and Bento. So they don't have – that's a two-sided marketplace, right? Drivers and customers, that's it. But you have this third party involved, which is the restaurants. You have to make sure that they're on board.
Yes.
And then you have Postmates out there, which is just a delivery service that'll do anything. And then there's DoorDash, and then I guess there was Grubhub, which had a formal relationship with restaurants. I don't know if it was exclusive or not. But then DoorDash, I remember, came in, and it seemed like you were able to get restaurants that maybe, and you correct me here if I'm wrong, but maybe they hadn't signed on board, so you could order In-N-Out Burger, which was like a miraculous thing. But then In-N-Out Burger was like, hey, DoorDash, we don't want you delivering that, and you had to take them out of the system. So how does it work? Do you have, is it like Postmates where you can order from anywhere, or do you have to have explicit permission from the restaurant? How does it work on DoorDash?
So we always want to work with all the restaurants
on
the platform. You know, the truth though is that it's very difficult sometimes to tell, you know, what the relationship's going to be like with every merchant, right? It's actually very difficult to predict who's going to be popular, believe it or not.
Yep.
It's very difficult to predict, you know, what are the small details that are going to make the operation successful or difficult. And so we always go into testing environments with all of our merchants first. Mm-hmm. We let them know that we're doing this. And the goal is to make sure that, you know, for the merchants that are receiving the demand, because there has to be a win-win, you know, situation for all sides here. We want to make sure the operations are as smooth as possible. So we integrate into their systems. They can choose to use our software, or we will, you know, integrate with theirs.
Their POS or whatever. Or
whatever systems.
Fax, whatever they want.
Whatever set of systems.
People still work off faxes largely?
Fax systems are still in vogue.
Hilarious.
They still are being used. Yes.
So somebody orders on DoorDash, picks what they want, and
yes,
literally you fire off with Twilio or some back-end API service a fax to the restaurant in some cases.
Sometimes.
That's hilarious.
Sometimes. I mean, But the technology is whatever solves the problem.
It's sure, of course.
So
what happened with In-N-Out? Because I got from your answer that you will work with them, but maybe in the past, did you just like sort of go around them and be like, hey, we got the menu, you can order what you want, and we'll just pick it up for you. It's like a delivery service.
It's a delivery service where we're testing out the demand as well as the operational kinks, right? And and so if it doesn't work out, obviously, you know, in the case of In-N-Out, for example, we stop serving them.
Right. So you did it without their permission at first, and they didn't like that.
We let them know that we're testing deliveries with them,
right?
And you know, they decided to, you know, not want to, you know, work together in the meantime.
Yeah. Now, if I order from Postmates, they'll still do it though, right? Because Postmates will go in there and not tell them they're like a delivery service. They'll just go order it.
I think that's how it works, but you may want to ask them.
No, it's basically Postmates takes the position. That's just like a person doing an errand for you. But is the issue putting the menu on the system? Like once you put the menu on the system, as opposed to you called it into a, you know, a messenger service, because you could, previously could order a messenger service, but it's having that menu in there that makes it super easy and the billing automatic.
Well, it's a lot of things. So menus, you're right. That's one, right? That's the first part.
Yeah.
And in fact, you know, menus change. Second of all, you know, how do you get in the orders accurately? How do you get them in there as quickly as possible? How do you get it in there to not disrupt the workflow of the kitchen? How do you take care of accounting systems, so on and so forth? I mean, the customer product, if you will, is just one part of the overall system, and you really have to make the system work.
Yeah, it seems. Does anybody negotiate exclusives now? Is it getting like sharp elbowed in your business now that you have the sort of the legacy company Grubhub, and then you have like Postmates over here, and then DoorDash is becoming like obviously the biggest of everything, I think.
Yeah, well,
are you guys fighting to have exclusives with certain restaurants? Does that matter, or does that exist in the space?
It's not what we think matters most. What we think matters most is, you know, I mean, for example, the analogy I always give is if I take off my wedding ring, I'm still married to my wife. I hope that it's not a sheet of paper or, you know, a piece of jewelry that signifies that relationship. And it's the same way I view, you know, our relationship with our merchants, right? We need to constantly, continuously serve them better every day. And if we can be the best people that serve them, then that's how we, you know, win, you know, any sort of partnership.
Right. So they're not exclusive to you, but you just want to be the best.
Yes.
Got it. Are the other companies trying to do exclusives and then block you out?
It's very difficult to do so if you think about it from just the point of view of the merchant, right? And again, I think this is where market forces dictate. And I think over time, the market rewards, you know, the best service.
Right.
That's what we believe.
What are the costs? Like break down the costs. If I wanted to order $40 worth of, you know, whatever, sushi or Chinese food or whatever, I'm hungry right now. My two favorite types of food. So if I want to order, you know, sushi right now, what do you get when I order sushi from a restaurant? What is the delivery fee? What is the charge to the restaurant? How does it work? Do you charge the restaurant?
Yes. So you, as the consumer, would pay us, you know, $4.99 for the delivery fee.
Got it.
And then we would charge a percent on the order to the merchant.
To the merchant. What's that? Yes. Like 3%, 4%, 5%?
We haven't disclosed that figure before.
So it's you get a piece on both sides.
Yes.
So if it was, I'm just going to pull the number 5% out, sounds reasonable, or 10%, you make $4 or $5 on one side, $4 or $5 on the other. You keep the money from the merchant, and you give the person delivering the other side, and they can do 3 orders an hour on average or something like that? Deliver 2 or 3 or 4?
Those are numbers that within the ballpark, I would say, but they make around 15 to 20 an hour.
Perfect, yeah, because if they get $5 three times plus tips, they could be in the 20. If they only do 2 an hour, they get whatever, 15. It's perfect. So let's talk about the margins then on the business, because this is the thing that everybody keeps talking about, this unit economics. So can you run a business in this space that can be profitable enough? Or is it, you know, just really, really operationally hard and just difficult, and you need to hit thousands of cities or, you know, whatever amount of money to build a, you know, a really significant business? Because obviously Uber's getting 20-25%. I don't know what exactly the percentages are there. That's a high percentage. I can't imagine a restaurant can give 25%, right? Or 20%. They can't give that kind of margin.
Well, they paid 20% to Grubhub, and Grubhub doesn't even provide the delivery driver.
Do they really?
Yeah.
Oh my God. Yeah. Grubhub is terrible. I have such a bad experience with that product. My experience with that product is, it's slower than when I order directly, and nobody ever responds. Like, they don't pick up the phone, they don't reply to email. Like, literally, I had problems. They replied to me 2 days later. Horrible service.
Well, the main challenge for a service like that is that they're a lead gen service, which means that by not offering the driver, two things kind of come to be. One, they can only serve 15% of the market. So that's the 15% of restaurants that offer delivery. And that's why you don't see a lot of restaurants, you know, in the Bay Area, for example, working with, you know, a service like Grubhub. And then two, quality control, kind of what you touched upon.
Yeah.
If you called Grubhub to ask about the status of your order, they would say, please call the restaurant.
Yeah.
How would they know, right? Yeah. How would they know? And so that's one of the challenges. But the answer to your first, you know, point though, is that both statements are true. It is operationally very difficult, and it is possible to build a profitable company. Our first, four markets are actually cash flow positive.
Oh, nice.
And to get to a position like that while growing at the pace that we're growing at, it requires a lot of complicated set of, you know, trade-offs daily. But it's not, you know, one of these things, right, where you have to wait until you amass such large volumes to make it work. But you do have to make a lot of good decisions every day.
All right, when we get back from this last sponsor message or partner message, I want to talk to you about the app and just show the app real quick. And then talk about maybe the impact, because there is this, you know, 800-pound gorilla that everybody's sort of like scared of Uber. Oh my God, they're huge right now. Uber now is doing Uber Eats as a separate app. And then is that competitive or not when we get back on This Week in Startups? Hey, everybody. I want to talk about one of my favorite addictions, Audible. I listen to audiobooks constantly because I love nonfiction. I love learning. And I'm big into bios. So my Audible pick for this month, this week, whatever amount of time it's going to take you to listen to it, I think you'll listen to it in about a week, is The Man Who Knew Infinity, A Life of the Genius Ramanujan. And this book is amazing. It is about an Indian clerk who is a math genius and who filled 3 or 4 books with math theories and formulas that today inform how we interpret black holes, and a true genius who then went to England to study. And it is being made into a film, which I was lucky enough to just see. And it's got Jeremy Irons and Dave Patel in it. It is an amazing, and Stephen Fry, and just an all-star cast. And I just saw this movie, and it is very powerful and a great, great film. And, you know, making math, you know, interesting, very hard to do. And there's a lot of these people who did seminal, incredible work, and you would never know them. The book is by Robert Kangel, and I actually saw the author speak with the director recently at a screening. And I, you know, immediately when I got invited to the screening, I said to myself, I'm going to go to screening for this book, but, you know, I want to go deeper. I always want to know not just the 90-minute or 120-minute version, but I like to read the original source material and I like to listen to it. I'm constantly in the car. I'm driving between things. Sometimes I got to take my daughter to a kid's party and then there's other parents there. I don't want to talk to them. So I pretend I'm on a conference call. Really, I'm listening to an Audible book while the kids are playing. The kids don't want to be involved with the parents, but the parents don't want to talk to me about some crazy nonsense. I just say, oh, I got to go make a phone call. I secretly listen to a little bit of Audible. So go check out The Man Who Knew Infinity. It is an amazing audiobook, and it is going to get my highest recommendation. Of course, if you're not into bios, there are a ton of other interesting books. One I'm reading on my hikes through the NorCal Mountains is Amusing Ourselves to Death by Neil Postman, who is I believe a New York University media kind of Marshall McLuhan type professor. And Amusing Ourselves to Death is my backup here. If you want to listen to an amazing book from 1985 about media and media theory and television versus the printed word in newspapers and before that books, and how illiterate and how television has become a huge nonsensical mess. We are actually amusing ourselves to death. If you look at what's happening in this election this year, you know, this is a really interesting book to go back and listen to, especially. And the way I wound up wanting to listen to Amusing Ourselves to Death was I had Keith Raboy at the Launch Festival. You may have heard that episode here. And he just mentioned casually, like when I was asking him about Donald Trump and Cruz and Hillary Clinton and Bernie Sanders, he said, yeah, you know, it reminds me of this incredible book, Amusing Ourselves to Death. And I was like, oh yeah, I didn't read that. And this is one of the things I love about audiobooks is, you know, sometimes you get older, you're whatever, you're 30 years old, you're 40 years old, you're 50 years old. You're supposed to have read some books. You know, you're supposed to be an expert. Listen, I'm supposed to be an expert on media and technology. I never read Amusing Ourselves to Death. I may have read a chapter or two when I was younger on the book, and now I have Audible. I listen to it on my hikes. I go for a two-hour hike. I knock out 2 out of the 7 hours. Boom, I got another hike, wipe out another 2 or 3 hours, go to the gym. I reward myself when I exercise with Audible. I reward myself when I'm driving with Audible. I like to make myself smarter. Thank you so much to our friends at Audible for supporting this episode. Get a free audiobook right now, like The Man Who Knew Infinity or Amusing Ourselves to Death. And you can just go to audible.com/twist, audible.com/twist. You know, some of my past recommendations, The Hobbit, you know, read by Robert Inglis is amazing. My daughter and I love listening to that. We've listened to the first 3 chapters over and over again because she likes certain scenes, like when the dwarfs are singing and breaking plates. And then before that, I did Building Great Sentences because you guys know I sold my book and it will be on Audible at some point next year. And I wanted to write better sentences. So I got this Building Great Sentences and it's really helped me do better sentences in my writing. And you can access your stuff from iPhones, iPad, Android, Windows, you know all that. What's really interesting is I have an iPad, I have my phone, and a lot of times I'll go from my iPad to my phone and it remembers where I was. So if you forget and, like, you know, my phone died on the hike, then I plugged in my iPad and I was listening on my deck, it remembered where I was and it caught me up when I was listening to Amusing Ourselves to Death. 180,000 titles in every genre, and they're doing some really interesting stuff with channels and podcasting. There's a bunch of stuff going on with Audible that you'll read about in the news. They're just an amazing company. I love it. Download my book of the week for free by signing up at audible.com/twist. You can only get that free book by going to audible.com/twist, and they love to see you do that. So make sure you tell your mom, your dad, your cousin, your brother, your sons, your daughters, your friends, your enemies. Tell them to go to audible.com/twist and get a free book. The Man Who Knew Infinity, a great, great listen. And Amusing Ourselves to Death, another great listen. Okay, let's get back to this amazing interview. Hey, everybody. Welcome back to This Week in Startups. My guest, Tony Hsu from DoorDash. You guys know DoorDash. If you're listening to this program, you've probably used it. They're in 24 cities, which is incredible. San Francisco, Los Angeles, New York, I'm assuming.
Yes.
Chicago,
Boston,
which
Dallas,
is the most?
Houston.
Who are the most? Let me ask you this question: who's the most difficult group of people? Like, who sends the most orders back? It's the most angry. Is it New York or Boston?
It's in. Why'd you pick those two cities?
Because I'm from New York, and, okay, and I know East Coast people are difficult at times. But now I'm thinking about, because I did spend time in LA. Those people can be passive aggressive too. So, but I think in New York, you probably have people get really upset about their food.
Well, I think in New York,
because they're passionate about their food.
They're a very educated type of customer, meaning that New York is the delivery mecca in the U.S.
Is it? Yeah, because of density.
Yeah, totally. And because, you know, half of the merchants there already deliver. And so they're very used. New York customers and residents are very used to this. And so I would say they certainly hold a high bar.
That is a diplomatic way of saying that's the most help tickets in Zendesk right now is from New York. They give you the hardest time, the New Yorkers.
I won't comment on who gives us the hardest time. We should make
I think
it
it's
such
the Boston
no,
people.
We should make it such that no one gives us a hard time.
Exactly. Well, the thing is, New York is a hard market because I was talking to somebody about Uber Eats and just Sprig and Spoon Rocket, which I guess is now defunct, and Bento and other ones in New York. And they were saying, like, I don't understand Bento. I don't understand Sprig because who cares if you get the food within 15 minutes? There's a deli across the street. I have a Chinese food place downstairs. I got an Indian place downstairs. Those guys bring the food up in 20 minutes, 25 minutes. It's like literally they don't have to cross the street. They're around the corner. They just have to make two rights and they're at my building. Because every block has an Indian, a Chinese, and a deli on it. You don't have to worry. So is it really hard to actually then for those on-demand like food providers, you think, to operate in those markets? Because it's such a short delivery time. What is the average delivery time in New York? 20 minutes? 30 minutes?
For those companies?
For you guys, for anybody.
Like it is a short window. It is a short window. But I wish it were as simple as it's just one thing that customers want. We've learned that, you know, some folks really like their eating preferences and their creatures of habit, and they really, you know, want to get sushi or Chinese food or whatever it might be from a certain set of restaurants. In other cases, they care a lot about speed. Mm. Other people care a lot about price.
Yeah.
And I think it's one of these decisions where it's actually fairly different for the broad swath of population.
That's what I like about DoorDash. I had like Postmates was just like so problematic for me because in the early days of Postmates, they would charge you a delivery fee, a tip, and a service charge on the amount. And I was talking to somebody, I was like, yeah, I think I spent like $18 or something or $20 on like $4 in delivery. Like, no, that's impossible. And we took out our phones and we looked and we're like, $16, $40 on food. I was like, wait a second. I mean, I know I can afford it, but it was just felt like all the charges were on the consumer side. So it just, the great part is you can order anything, but you're going to pay through the nose when you use those services. I think the nice part about DoorDash is you get the good restaurants and it's only $5.
Yeah, I mean, it is a complicated system, right? Mm-hmm. And you have to make it work for all audiences.
God, it's so difficult, man, just to grind it out like that.
It is a grind. It is truly a daily grind.
What is the hardest part right now about the business? Is it launching new cities? Is it acquiring drivers? What's the most challenging part? Because you got tons of money. You have people who love the product. You got customers. Restaurants love it. But what's hard now at for you? Are you a first-time entrepreneur? Is your second company? Or?
First time.
Yeah. So what's hard now? Because obviously everything's hard in the beginning, but what's hard now, like in year five or whatever it is, four?
Yeah, year two and a half. It's everything.
How is it only year two and a half?
Yeah.
24 cities in 30 months?
We move quickly. But what I'll say is, I mean, nothing ever feels easier. Nothing feels more easily. I mean, you're saying how, well, maybe getting customers is easy or maybe getting drivers is easy or restaurants. It actually is all equally hard. But I think for me, daily activity-wise, you know, the attention shifts a bit more from the product to, say, the company,
uh-huh.
right? With, you know, when it was just 20 people out of a two-bedroom apartment, my two-bedroom apartment, that's one thing.
It's a pretty big two-bedroom.
It's pretty tight, 900.
Pretty crammed.
Yeah, it's the latter. It's 900 square feet. So total.
Hey, everybody had 40 square feet. I mean, two guys in the bathtub. And you know.
Yeah, yeah. Actually, we pretty much made use of every square feet.
Kitchen.
But, yeah, but no, the attention shifts more towards building the company as the product, right? And so with 200 people, how do you think about communication? How do you think about, improving culture, not just maintaining what we had,
right?
How do you think about, we have over 12 software products. How do you think about, the investment choices you make in all of those products? How do you think about the future versus, the current day? I think, when it was just in Y Combinator, it's every day, all you're doing is doing. We're doing the deliveries, my co-founders and me, and I, every day for the first 6 months.
Yeah, the idea is to do it as lean and agile as possible. Like, whatever the simplest way to do it is and have it grow is what your goal is at an incubator, right? Just to prove out the concept.
Yes. I think proving out to yourself before you try to prove it to anyone else is the most important thing.
How do you shift that sort of growth at all cost to, I don't want to say more professional, but more sustainable maybe?
Well, I don't think it should ever be growth at all costs necessarily.
Were they in your cohort?
I don't know about Zenefits. The Zenefits was A year ahead, either a year or 6 months ahead.
They were in the class.
We were summer 2013. They might have been the class before us. For us, I can tell you, it wasn't growth at all costs, right? For us, it was, I mean, proving to ourselves, is this something customers actually wanted? That was actually my biggest skepticism, by the way.
Do customers want?
Well, because if 85% of restaurants don't deliver, maybe there's a very good reason why. Maybe there's a market reason why.
Yeah.
Two, will, you know, Dashers actually want to partner with us at a wage we can afford? And three, will restaurants pay us, right? And so, you know, until we proved those three points, we actually didn't, for the first 60%, year and a half, basically, of our life, we were in two markets only. Hmm. So most of the 24 markets came in the last 12 months.
Wow. So you roll, when you roll out a city, do you roll out like three in a month? Or do you do like, do you have a SWAT team like they
did at
Uber?
We do have a launch team.
Yeah.
Yeah, we do have a launch team. And
the old playbook?
We have a continuously updating playbook, yes.
Yeah.
You know, and we have tremendous people who know what they're doing. And obviously, you know, you make each launch better than the previous one.
Yeah, you just add whatever you learned.
Yeah.
So what is the impact of Uber Eats? Because everybody's like, oh my God, Uber comes into a market, they win everything. It's like, it's not exactly the case. But Uber Eats seems like it's a pretty good product now. I think they've taken the approach of picking the most unique meals in that city and putting them in the back of cars, I guess refrigerator, whatever, and so you can get them very quick, but it's a very limited amount of inventory. Have they had an impact on your business, or is it like people use it in different circumstances?
So we haven't seen one, an impact. And I think part of the thing here, you know, again, we all live in Silicon Valley. I'm originally from the Midwest. And so I tend to try to, you know, think about the world, you know, what, as, you know, my friends would in the Midwest, which is, we're all very small in this segment, right? People, I think, forget that we're in a very small part of the very fast growing segment of food, which is delivery, right? 85% of restaurants never offered delivery before.
Right.
So we're in that tiny percent, you know, growing very, very quickly. We're not actually, part of an existing market that's very, very large. And so as a result, I think, you know, all of the services are seeing some levels of success because of that.
Do you do like that quick bites, like the quick, you know, get something right now in 10 minutes, it's in the back of the car already? Or is that, you don't believe in that?
We don't currently offer that.
Yeah. What do you think of that space? Is it just too limited, the amount of selection? Or how do you decide which thing to focus on? Because I think Spoon Rocket went out of business. Sprig, I think, and what's the other one? Shervin's an investor in. What's the other big delivery service that does meals that are prepared from a central kitchen? It's like the central kitchen kind of concept. I forgot the name of it. Munchery. Right, Munchery has like prepared meals. How do you look at those businesses? You think they're just not not as good, interesting of a business as the one you have because of selection, or?
No, I think you have to focus on what you're good at. Yeah. I think companies are built inside out, not by analogy or by looking at what's hot and what's working. For us, we're a bunch of math geeks who started the company, right? We don't know anything about making food, right?
Yeah.
And in fact, you know, our idea is, you know, let each side of the marketplace be. Our restaurateurs, they know how to make food.
Yeah.
Right? And they know that best. They know that way better than we will ever know. Right? Our Dashers make it as easy as possible for them to work. And our consumers obviously make it, you know, reduce as much friction as we can from the ordering process. And, you know, for us, you know, we know how to write software. Why do we have so many software products? It's because most of the software actually no one sees. It's to, you know, figure out how do we make smart decisions every single time? How do we learn from how do we train our own systems to learn from those decisions over time so that we can use technology to offer the logistics and the power of that to all these merchants?
Are there some things that just don't work in terms of this like food delivery that you just say like, we should just eliminate this sector of restaurants or this area? Because I know when I lived in LA, I lived in Brentwood, and I had friends who lived up the hill in Bel Air, and no restaurants would ever deliver there because finding the house and literally like the time from the gate at the house up to the house was probably as long as delivering something in Santa Monica. Like for a lot of these houses, would take them literally 90 minutes to get food delivered. And if they would deliver it at all.
Yeah. So you're right. There are definitely certain deliveries that are more difficult than others, right? You know, for us though, we're always about offering the widest selection. And for us to be able to do something like that to all of our customers and make, you know, delivery accessible to everyone, kind of have to serve everyone.
Really?
But look, you can make, even within, you know, that mission, you can make smart decisions, right? And you can edit the product.
Right.
And you can edit the systems. But it takes a lot of work.
Do you charge more for certain long hauls or?
Nope.
So the same amount, can you deliver to like Bel Air up in the hill and everything like that just as easily as Westwood?
I didn't say just as easily.
Oh, you'll still do it.
Yeah, we still do deliveries.
See, I think a more fair system would be the time it takes to deliver is like in an area like LA or the distance, like there has to be some sort of a surcharge because if you just think about the people who are the, you know, sure they could average it out, but what a bummer if you have to like take your little scooter or your bicycle from Westwood all the way up to Bel Air and climb that hill. It's impossible like to make that run work.
Sure. And it's up to, so, but it's up to DoorDash. It's up to us, right, to make that decision in the sense that, you know, how do we, and this is what I was saying earlier, right? Like this is really a complicated math problem, right? Keep it simple for the consumer, easy to understand, flat fee, right? But how do we then, you know, build the technology, everything in the background to make a set of, you know, choices such that the system works in a very simple way?
Ah, so you could actually say, hey, DoorDasher, to the Dasher, you're going to get 2X for bringing this all the way up the hill maybe or something if it's a longer distance. You could have variable payments for the deliveries.
Sure.
Are there variable payments for the deliveries?
There can be, yes.
There can be, yeah. See, that makes sense to me. So you have figured that out. I was always wondering, because what my friend used to do was he would literally call, you know, a restaurant in Westwood and say, I'm going to give you a $50 tip to bring up this $150 in food or $100 in food. When he'd have people over and say, I'll literally put $50 delivery service on it and I'll give the guy a $20 tip. Just, I know it's a pain in the ass. And like, that was the only option he had. He had to literally call them and lobby them. And even then they would be like, we just can't do it. It's going to take the guy an hour to get up there and back. Sunset's a disaster.
Yeah, I mean, you want to start by offering very simple to understand low friction type of product.
Yeah.
Right? And it's up to you, the company, to figure out the complications. Right? Yeah. And over time, you know, you can certainly make the system more complicated. Right? All the things you talked about, make it more complicated.
Right.
You know, to interact with that system.
Right. Hey, let's see the app here.
Sure.
For people who haven't seen it, we'll just pull it up here for a second. Sure. I'll do a little sports casting, or you can sports cast it. We'll pull up the app here on the screen. And obviously, it's for iOS and Android. You can go ahead and
iOS, DoorDash. Android, DoorDash.com, you know, website, also mobile web as well. So this is our office address here at the top. We can, you know, obviously search for different cuisine types, as well as what is trending or popular. We can click on, you know, categories, you know, Chinese food, for instance, that are nearby. We've built
RG Lounge.
We've built in
that
what we
place
call
is amazing. Get the Dungeness crab there.
It is a very popular choice, Jason. You know, we
Peking duck's pretty good there too.
We've built in, you know, our own delight score, which is which is a score that we use to help, you know, figure out the delivery quality, right? This is based on, you know, user ratings. This is based on, you know, performance of merchants, so on and so
forth. You
know
what the
best
part of this is?
Yeah.
The number of minutes. I always appreciate that about the product. It's that, you know, like 31 minutes, 33 minutes, like, you could either say 30 minutes or 35 and never put a single digit.
Yeah.
I just love the decision to say 32 versus 33.
Yeah.
Because you know what it tells me? Like, you actually are measuring. Even if you're not, and even if it doesn't matter, 3 minutes doesn't have a consequence in your food arriving, 1, 2, 3 minute difference. I just love the fact that you're measuring it.
What actually really matters to us.
Right.
And the reason is because, again, you know, it's this complicated system in the back, mm-hmm. right? We call it Deep Red, which is the name of our algorithm, actually. That's making a set of very difficult decisions, you know, just-in-time decisions about, you know, which Dasher, where, how do we move people around so that, you know, we don't have to have a poor biker climbing the hills of Bel Air, so on and so forth.
Right.
Right. And
right. The biker is in Westwood.
Yeah.
The scooter is...
Or the car.
Or the car. In LA, you have a lot of scooters and motorcycles. I've always been amazed that people do delivery on cars, not on Vespas. In Europe, everything's Vespas.
Yeah, but in LA, there are a lot of cars.
In Asia, it's all Vespas.
Sure. Well, I mean, LA is also very spread out. So, yeah. I mean, there are parts of LA where a car certainly beats a bicycle or a Vespa.
I guess so. If you don't have the motorcycle license.
Yeah, I mean, maybe along Ocean Avenue in Santa Monica, sure.
Yeah.
You know, a Vespa beats a car, but... You know, climbing the hills of Bel Air, different story.
Maybe. Now, do you know now that you're 30 months into this incredible business, do you know, like, when I order the Peking duck, that that's going to take an extra 20 minutes? Or are you to that level yet, in all honesty, that you know when I order a certain dish, you can say, by the way, Peking duck takes an extra 20 minutes for them to slice up. Be prepared for it to be a 40-minute wait.
We're getting pretty close. We're not there yet.
Is that the holy grail, is to be able to know the restaurant's yield management combined with, like, certain dishes take longer?
It's one part. It's certainly one part. Data collection, right, is certainly one part. You cannot build a great training set for a machine learning model if you have poor data, right? So collecting information, high fidelity information from various sources, that is very important. We're not quite there yet, but we've gotten pretty close. I mean, obviously estimating prep times is a very important part.
And so now do you provide a tool back to the restaurants for them to know, like, hey, here's where you stand amongst Thai restaurants or amongst Brentwood Village restaurants. You're, hitting this average time for us to pick up the food. You may want to think about simplifying your menu or being faster to delivery.
We absolutely want to offer actionable insights to our merchants to better their operations, right? This is not just for delivery, by the way, right? Maybe by figuring out changes in prep times, we can figure out when they are short-staffed or overstaffed, for example, right?
Yeah.
And that could be a decision up to management or, the staff themselves to figure out whether they want to change.
Yeah, see, that's, I think, the really interesting thing about the data here is you can actually give them insights for the first time that they didn't know, because I'm sure they must be sitting there. Like, if I owned RG Lounge,
right,
I would be sitting there looking at my time, delivery time, and then I'd be changing my address on my phone and want to know a heat map of, like, how we're doing.
Yeah.
And then I'd be to the staff like, hey, listen, you got to par cook the Dungeness crab and have it ready to go. We're getting killed on the Dungeness crab here. Like, we got to have a better system, or we got to tell people Dungeness crab is, whatever extra number of minutes, so that Tony at DoorDash doesn't penalize us and put our agony score at 49.
I wish, Jason, that every restaurateur thought like you did. but the truth is, having seen my mom, run a restaurant, there are 50 things the restaurateur thinks about every single day.
Isn't it brutal? My dad owns restaurants too. We have this in common.
Yeah. And so
did it like create massive stress inside your family running a restaurant?
Yes.
It was so hard for my
business,
family.
Not just, even my mom's current small business.
Yeah. But the restaurant specifically, because you have to be there at the crack
hustle
of the day.
Bustle.
You have to close the place up.
Yes.
You have to deal with employees.
Yes.
And you're barely getting by no matter what. It's so hard.
Yes. Yes, it is very difficult. And you don't want to add another thing to their, checklist, right? You want to make it as simple as possible for them to work with someone like us.
So hard. They took my dad's restaurant because he didn't pay his taxes for a couple of years. He didn't pay the alcohol. Like, these guys are humorless. Like, when you don't pay your alcohol tax, they came with shotguns and took the place. The feds. You want to talk about a traumatic experience? You read my book when it comes out. It'll be a chapter in the book.
It's brutal. It's a brutal business. But, it's what sustains two-thirds of the economy any decade.
I get pitched all the time on, like, the restaurant business. Like, hey, you want to invest in my restaurant? Hey, you want to? I'm just like, never. Never. I just watched how hard it was. And these people have my respect if they open a restaurant, because the margins are low. You have to deal with customers and the public. You have perishable food. It's so goddamn hard, man.
It's very hard. You have to love it. You have to love it.
You have to love it. You're basically, your mom, when she ran a restaurant, did she just, like, it was like making a living, like being your own boss, but she probably could have worked somewhere else and worked half as many hours and made the same amount of money.
Probably, if money were her sole desire, yes.
Right, she needed to be her own boss.
Yes, and she likes what she was doing. She loved her customers.
Right.
Right, and it's like a startup. If you don't love it, you're not going to make it.
What kind of food was it?
Chinese food.
Chinese food?
Yeah.
What kind of Chinese food? Like, was it like high end? Or was it, was it General Tso's? Was it like takeout? Was it like a takeout? Like,
I grew up in Champaign, Illinois. So tiny college town.
Ah.
Big university, small town though.
Right.
And so no. So high end Chinese restaurants wouldn't work super well in Champaign.
So this is like you have to like make General Tso's chicken for drunk college kids?
Not always drunk college kids, but yeah. Casual restaurants.
It was a
casual dining restaurant.
Yeah.
Now it was a sit down.
Oh, it was sit down too.
Yeah, it was a sit down.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, it just.
I mean, college students came all the time, but I mean, it was a sit down.
Hard business, man. It's so hard.
It is
what does your
business.
Mom think now when she sees you running a company that's raised $200 million and operates in 24 cities and represents thousands of restaurants? Is she just like, how does she even, like, what's it like at Christmas? Is she just like, oh God, I'm so proud of you? Or
I think she knows how hard it is. And she, you know, saw me not only as a dishwasher in her restaurant, you know, as a kid, but she saw me, you know, do deliveries for DoorDash, right? Yeah. Actually, it's, you know, still I do deliveries for DoorDash.
Dishwasher is such a hard job. And I did that.
Yeah, well, anything in the back of the house.
Your hands are so raw.
Anything in the back of the house.
You know, you get that steel wool.
Dishwashing, line cook, any job in the back of the house is very
so brutal. That's why I immediately became a busboy and then a waiter. And I was doing the prep chef.
You upgraded to the front of the house and you found...
It was so much easier dealing with the public.
Yeah.
You know, as hard as that can be at times.
Sure.
Than just how raw your hands were. I always remember that steel wool, you know, that like Brillo kind of steel wool. You have to scrub the pots and pans. And the chef, Donnie Penza or, you know, Richie Steff, they would just throw the pan at the sink. You get hit by a sizzling pan and just throw it in the sink. Whoa, you got to pick it up. And
it's four back there. No, it was
so hard.
It was a great first job.
What was it like doing deliveries for Domino's? That's got to be miserable.
It was 2 weeks. I mean, two weeks. I don't want to, it was really learning, you know. It's an amazing thing they do, by the way.
Sure it is. Yeah. They make a pizza in like 8 minutes or something.
And fulfilling, you know, 1.5, I believe, million deliveries per day in the U.S. That's incredible scale.
They've done a good job with their app now, huh? They got their app is actually, like, it looks ugly, but at my poker game,
yeah,
one of my guys has got the Domino's app.
Yeah.
And he presses it, and it's got this, like, ugly fakaka, you know, status bar.
Okay.
It looks terrible. You don't see a map with the driver on it. None of this fancy stuff.
Right.
But he can one-click order what we ordered last time.
And that works.
And it just works. And so it's like, yeah, it's ordered, bang, back to the next hand of poker.
Well, I think that's important, right? That you've kind of made an important point here, which is that placing the order is just one part of the app. No matter how good or bad it looks, Domino's does 1.5 million deliveries per day, right?
Crazy.
Building the system to support that is very, very difficult. And that's something that I greatly admire.
So where are you at next? Because we had this whole unicorn thing, and you, I think, you know, if you raise $127 million, you know, the company's worth more than that. So it's got to, you know, usually when people put $127 in a Series C, that would be for 20% of the business or 15 or 10 or something in that range. So your business is worth hundreds of millions of dollars. Congratulations, maybe $1 billion, I don't know. Was the valuation public or no?
No, we never talk about valuations at any of our financings.
So suffice it to say, you're either close to being what we call a unicorn in the business or a unicorn, but the market has corrected over the last year, and this sort of free money, everybody just gets $1 billion, everybody gets $100 million round, has changed. How is the unicorn, you know, sort of deflation, you know, the bubble hasn't popped, but certainly the free money market and the late stage people coming in has changed radically. Have you had to think about your business differently and how you spend money and lowering burn rates? Bill Gurley's been writing about this a lot, like, hey, we have to get unit economics positive. Hey, we have to be profitable in cities. And I guess Uber just recently said, like, I'm an investor, but I don't have inside information. I just read in the press. They actually announced they had 19 cents per ride they made or something. There's a newfound focus on profitability. Is that impacting your business, or have you always just been like, we're going to make this profitable from day one? How have things changed for you with this deflation that occurred?
It's been more the latter.
Yeah.
And we've always, I mean, I think if you have to wait for an investor to tell you to focus on your unit economics, you may have some other things to worry about. I think the macro environment certainly has impacted, frankly, all companies, right? And I think the biggest, you know, impact is, it sometimes causes a very pessimistic group think, right? To kind of clump all companies together as part of some doom and gloom theme.
Yes.
It makes it maybe more difficult to really, talk about companies individually. Instead, you know, reinforces this group think mentality that sometimes occurs amongst investors. And I think, you know, how do we tell that narrative of, you know, what makes us different all of a sudden becomes a bigger challenge.
And what do you think the core difference is between you and the other unicorns out there?
Well, I don't know about, you know, the other companies. You know, for us, you know, it from day one, it was a belief that the score will take care of itself in the long run, right? So build the business correctly, right? Who cares if it, up market, down market, whatever. I mean, the markets are going to change. And frankly, that's not in our control. So let's not worry too much about it. yes, we obviously are impacted by it, but let's not, you know, obsess over it. Let's instead obsess over our customers. Let's obsess over, you know, things within our control and do those things right.
It's well said, because you don't have control over the market out there. And if you look at the great CEOs like Netflix and Google and Facebook, obviously after they went public, I mean, a lot of people got demolished in the public markets. Their shares went down. I don't know, Facebook maybe went $16, $17, $18 a share when they, you know, then rocketed back up. You know, like Facebook was never a bad business. It just fell out of favor with investors after they went public for a short period of time, a year or less. And then they came rocketing back. Netflix went out of favor, was whatever, single digits a share. Now, boom, they just get House of Cards and everything. Daredevil, they figure it out and they're crushing it. You have to stay focused on the core metrics of your business.
Yes.
Yeah. So what's next?
Well, I mean, for DoorDash, you know, this year is really about adding to the momentum we've already had. You know, I talked about our 24th market.
Yeah.
We launched that a week ago. Just, you know, established a partnership with Carl's Jr. as well as
Cheesecake
Factory.
Yeah, what's that about? How do you get the fast food people involved in this? Because that to me seems like a very low margin business. I don't know if it is or not. I could be wrong, but are they lower margin businesses or higher margin businesses? I would think fast food wouldn't want to be involved in this. Maybe there's not enough margin. How do they make it work?
Well, so fast food, it depends on the scale that you operate at.
Ah.
And don't forget that, you know, people like Carl's Jr., I mean, there are only so many of them, right? And, and their ability to, you know, purchase supply, for example, or raw ingredients is at a very different cost basis than maybe, say, you know, a smaller type of—
a mom and pop hamburger shop.
Yeah.
It's not going to get the same deal as Carl's Jr. on buns.
Yes. And so, their margin structure, you know, is actually fairly robust.
Oh.
And it may be surprising to some people, you know, not in the space. So yeah, I mean, for us, it's really adding to that. Carl's Jr., Cheesecake Factory, and for us this year,
you have Dunkin' Donuts.
We do have Dunkin' Donuts.
I didn't know that. So I can order Dunkin' Donuts. Is there a Dunkin' Donuts in?
There are very few out here. They're obviously headquartered in Boston. Your favorite place, it sounds like.
No, not a fan of Boston.
No, for a New Yorker, probably not true.
I hate the Celtics. I hate the Red Sox.
Yeah.
People from Boston.
Well, there are a lot of New York.
I kind of respect people from Boston. I got to be honest, but I don't like them.
Okay, a lot of Dunkin' Donuts in New York too. But anyways, and so we're working with some fantastic national players as well. This year is really about continuing on the expansion that we've already made and building foundation for other types of things that we may deliver.
Ah. So you may get into other delivery services.
Well, DoorDash was built to create delivery networks for small businesses, not necessarily
just food.
Small restaurants.
Right.
We wanted to certainly make sure that we could do one thing well before we earned the right, you know, to do other things.
Right.
So I think we still have a ways to go in the restaurant core, but we've always had our ambitions elsewhere too.
Yeah, this Amazon delivering the basic stuff in the same day, it's pretty amazing here. It's really interesting because you live in San Francisco, you get a totally warped view of what the rest
world.
Of the country world exists, you know, what exists in the rest of the world. But
yes,
I order stuff on Amazon and it feels like I click order and the doorbell rings in Pack Heights here in San Francisco. Like literally you order it and it says, yeah, that's going to come today. And I'm like, really? I'm ordering a cable and an extra battery for my phone and it's going to be here today? It would have taken me longer to go to Circuit City or Best Buy, whatever, whichever one's still open. I don't know which one's still open. Best Buy still open, Circuit City's gone. One of them's gone. I don't know which one.
Yeah, Best Buy's still here.
Best Buy's still around. So, like, to go to Best Buy to park and get the thing, I think it takes longer than to just order an HDMI cable on Amazon today. Amazon doesn't do food, though.
Actually, they've done food.
They have.
They have. I think people forget that Amazon, you know, for example, did groceries.
Oh, right. They did Amazon Fresh.
9 years ago, starting 9 years ago. It's still around.
It's still around. You know,
Amazon
I did
Fresh
it.
Is still
and,
around.
Nah, it didn't work for us. My wife didn't like the quality of the stuff, so she uses Instacart.
Okay.
But Instacart just started charging us $10 a month to be a member or something like that.
I don't know.
It has a membership fee now because I was like, everybody was telling me Instacart, like, negative gross margin business. Like, it's not going to work. It can't. There's not enough margin. Da, da, da. And then they raised their prices, right? It's this whole unicorn thing, whatever. And my wife's like, oh, they raised their prices. I said, baby, this is a good thing. You love Instacart, like, for delivering eggs or bacon or whatever. Like,
right.
We want them to be sustainable. I think it's a big misnomer. It's like a lot of these young entrepreneurs think, I have to lose money on every transaction. What if I raise my prices? It's like, yeah, challenge your customers to pay a fair price. Like, $5 delivery charge is a bargain, right? Like, To me, $5 seems low. $6, $7, $8 seems more appropriate. I don't know.
Well, I think there's different customers and willingness to pay. But I mean, I guess it depends on the restaurant. I think the approach, I mean, the advice I would, I mean, what I say internally at the company as well as I would say externally is build a product that's worth the value.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, that's really what it's about at the end of the day, right? Yeah.
How is this... And what's your take on this minimum wage thing? There's a big minimum wage movement. So $15 to $20 an hour, it's like, oh yeah, 50% double minimum wage. But isn't minimum wage going to $15 an hour? Are we all going to expect that? Because then your whole thing with the Starbucks people leaving for, because they're going to pay 10 to 12 to come to DoorDash to make 15 to 20, well, they're going to have to get paid 15. So how is this minimum wage movement that's just really happened? I think LA, Seattle, and San Francisco are the big proponents of it. How do you think that's going to impact your business and just other businesses and these kind of jobs? Are you going to have to raise prices based on that? Because it's going to be a 50% increase in the minimum wage, I think, for a lot of cities.
So I think it's tough to tell right now, right? I think part of it, don't forget, is that, you know, we're not exactly the primary source of income. And so some of these retailers that you're talking about where these folks work may have to, you know, think about how they're going to be able to deal with these minimum wage increases first, right? And we obviously work to service these retailers, and we're kind of partners in this together. And so I think it really depends on how that works first, because for us, folks are choosing us for the flexibility first before the pay.
Right. So as long as they're going to clear the minimum wage, you're good. It's if so they're not going to be under it, but it might not be as far away from the minimum wage as it was. So you might have to raise it You might have to raise a delivery fee a dollar or two is what I would predict. There'd probably be a $6 delivery fee at some point.
We'll see how it works out.
It's going to be interesting because people don't like to talk about the minimum wage or this issue of labor here in Silicon Valley because it typically leads to automation. And what I've heard from a lot of people is all these fast food restaurants and what this minimum wage discussion has done is it's just hastened the automation of things like the cashier. So I think Panera Bread is just going no cashiers. You just go up to a kiosk, like the Itza Quinoa place here in San Francisco, where you just order from a kiosk. Like, why would you ever make somebody sit at a register to take money? It's so dumb. Just swipe a credit card, order your stuff, and then go to the box and pull it out. You don't need to have that person. I think all of this minimum wage stuff in certain cities is just going to result in the reduction of these jobs. Not that I'm against minimum wage raising, but it is this counterbalance.
Yeah, I've always had the belief that, again, like, what's the point of technology, right? It's not to just write software just for our interest here in Silicon Valley, right? Yeah. It's hopefully to solve some problem. So I think before we jump to solutions like automation, right? What is the problem that we're trying to solve, right? Is it truly just a labor cost issue? Well, then there's probably other ways to solve that problem too.
Yeah.
Right. Maybe we can get governments involved.
Yeah.
Right. And instead of fighting these huge battles with one another. So I think it really depends on what the problem we're trying to solve is.
I think it's crazy when you think about the cost of living is so the disparity between the cost of living where you grew up,
right,
and San Francisco is what? What was a one-bedroom? It's $1 bedroom in San Francisco is $4,000, $3,500.
When my parents first immigrated to this country, I think, well, we didn't have much money, but we had like a couple hundred bucks in the bank, but it was $120 for a three-bedroom apartment.
In Champaign, Illinois?
A month, yeah. I mean, it was subsidized graduate student housing, but still,
right.
Yeah.
So what is it now? Like a one-bedroom there is probably $800 or something?
Yeah, probably less.
$600.
Yeah, $600 to $1,000.
And here it's $2,500 to $4,000.
Yeah, it's not.
So
it's not comparable.
How do you take a minimum wage in a city like, or in a district like Manhattan or Brooklyn, San Francisco, Santa Monica, and compare it to, the rest of the country? It's not comparable.
It's not.
So what's going to happen is, I think this national, the whole idea of a national minimum wage, like, sure, that maybe could be a floor,
right?
But it has to be something set on a local city by city basis. Because they're going to just eliminate swaths of jobs. Like Yelp is like, we're not going to have customer support here. Like, we're not going to have these millennials. You were that millennial blogger who wrote like how terrible her life is.
I didn't read the blog, but I was told about it.
Yeah. Like, she's like, oh my God, my life is so terrible. I have to commute 40 minutes. And I was like, my commute was 90 minutes when I got my first job, but okay. But they just said, we're just going to ship these jobs to Arizona or wherever, because you just can't have a $12 or $14 an hour job in San Francisco. It just doesn't make any sense anymore.
So the cost of living certainly makes it difficult, right, to build a company, say, in San Francisco, right? Yeah. I mean, it's these jobs, obviously, also the jobs of engineers and, you know, other types of workers as well.
Have you, do you have offices, like, in other places to do this geographic rebalancing?
We have very small offices, one-bedroom apartments, if you will,
yeah,
in each of the different markets.
Oh, really? So you just get like a little WeWork closet or something?
We set up that way. And it's how we started the company, you know, in Palo Alto. And if we can outgrow it, then that's probably a good sign.
What's interesting about that is, since you're already a multi-city company, if it turns out Boston is the place to get engineers, which is, hey, listen, I know I've been riding Boston a little bit hard here. I'm going to get a lot of people hitting me back on it. But there's a lot of smart cats there, and the cost of living is half of here. So you could actually hire a lot of incredible engineers there out of MIT and Harvard and other places.
I mean, talent is equally distributed. I mean, it really is. I truly believe that. I mean, how do you access that talent? I think is a tricky question, right? That access may not be equally distributed.
What about international markets? We'll wrap up there, but how do you look at international markets? Obviously, China is just out of the question. I mean, isn't it? Like, there's just so much activity over there with the delivery services, like, to try and come in there now as an American company. I mean,
yeah. I mean, I think there are few industries where, you know, China is, you know, ahead. I mean, not just China, many Asian, I would say, markets are ahead of where the U.S. and other Western countries are. You know, the on-demand space is one of them.
Yeah.
Right. So China certainly is a very difficult market. Yeah. But we're certainly looking at opportunities across the board.
Yeah. So you'll start going to other places, other locations geographically outside of the U.S. Are you outside the U.S. now, or?
Just Canada.
Oh, just Canada.
Yeah. Toronto, Vancouver.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
How's that market? Is it good or?
Yeah, I think most people forget about it, but so far, so great.
Yeah, see, that's the thing, is that people forget that in China, Korea, I mean, there's a longstanding tradition of people actually doing delivery food there for, you know.
Well, deliveries of any sort, I would say. Food, non-food, et cetera.
Yeah, they have these metal canisters in Korea that they stack. They're sort of like bento boxes in Japan, but have you seen them? They're like metal, and they stack, and they have a handle on the top.
I've seen the ones in India.
India is the same ones, right?
It's amazing, actually.
It's amazing, yeah. These guys, there's a type of person who, they take these stacks of metal circles, they clamp them together, but the wife at home makes them, gives it to the delivery guy. The delivery guy goes to all the houses, collects from all the wives, because it is the way it works there. It's not a sexist thing to say in India. It's accurate. These delivery guys go and they pick up from each house. The wife makes lunch for the husband at 10 o'clock, let's say.
Yes.
They put 40 of these things, 50 of these things on a cart. Emmy Award-winning producer Jackie will look up the name of this. It's a very specific name.
Dabba Wallace.
You know it,
yes.
Dabba Wallace.
Yeah, so the Dabba Wallace, I've studied many logistics systems across the world.
Isn't it amazing?
The Dabba Wallace FedEx actually commissioned a study with Harvard Business School to study the Dabba Wallace, because using nothing but colored markers, believe it or not, so that's the technology, okay? They actually have, they do millions of deliveries per day in one city, in Mumbai, and they have a higher accuracy rate, lower error rate than FedEx.
It's amazing.
Using their system.
It's wild to watch. I've seen the pictures in this study and this other stuff with these Dabba Wallahs, and like, they put them on carts and then they go on trains to meet the husbands and give them their
thing. Before we talk about automation, right?
Then they collect them and bring them back in the afternoon.
Yes.
So there's literally a guy, I think the probably average one takes 50 of these things or something, or 30 of these things, puts them on a cart, brings them at 10, picks them up at 10, drops them off at noon, brings them back at 3, and then does the same thing tomorrow. And somehow that makes sense, rather than buying lunch at the place. And it turns out the Dabba Wallahs, I think people, the tradition is you want to eat home-cooked food. You don't want to eat restaurant food. You don't want to eat cafeteria food. It's better to eat what your spouse has created for you, or your home-cooked meal.
Yeah, and it's also more affordable too. I would say it just goes to show, right? I mean, that solution, right? You know, beats a lot of the automated systems that even FedEx has produced. And so, you know, I think the point of technology is to solve problems. And so, I think the Dabba Wallahs is a fine example of one.
Here it is. I'm pulling it up on my screen. You got to see this. If you're not watching the video version of This Week in Startups, here it is. here's the canisters. We're seeing them here on the scene. And here's the guy like tying them up. They put them over their shoulders. They put them on bicycles. Maybe they even just have dozens of them. I don't even know. But it is a wild, wild delivery system.
Yeah, it's actually a multi-system in terms of who they pass off the deliveries to, so on and so forth. It's quite a great
study. Yeah, because look, see, they're organizing them here in the street. What you don't, if you're listening to this, there's like 10 guys in the street organizing stacks of them. And I guess they put them on a train or they put them into these huge carts
bike,
now.
Bike, train, walking, all of the above.
Yeah, look at this. The guys are getting on a train,
yes,
on a cart of these. Then they get off the cart. Then they put them on bicycles because they leave their bicycle at the station. Incredible. And look at them. They're all like colored and like there's like a train station with 100 of these things on the side of the road.
Millions per day.
Millions per day. And so if that's the case, if the Dubwalas can get it right, then Tony, you can get my Dungeness Crab and from RG Lounge, correct?
Yeah.
RG Lounge is amazing.
It's a fantastic place.
What's your favorite Chinese in the city? You have a recommendation for Hong Kong Lounge? RG Lounge?
RG Lounge is definitely
Yang Sing for dim sum.
Yang Sing for dim sum is pretty good. Mama G's in the Castro.
Oh, yeah?
It's pretty good.
I don't know that one. You got any Daily City kind of like out by Lucky Chances kind of like? I heard there's some stuff down there in Chinese
There is a dim sum place that whose name I'm blanking on in Daily City.
This is what I keep hearing about. There's this dim sum place in Daily City.
It's a long wait. Yeah.
It's a long wait.
I'll email it to you.
Yeah. See, I got a Chinese guy here who's from China. I got to ask you this. I'm like a huge Chinese food fetish right now. I'm like so into Peking duck.
Okay.
Like I eat it like once a week. That's why I got fat again.
It's tough to get in the city. I mean, it's tough.
I know where I go is I go to Richmond, Inner Richmond. There's Hong Kong Lounge, I think it's called. Right. 1 and 2.
Yeah, Hong Kong Lounge.
Hong Kong Lounge.
Popular restaurant.
Yeah, 1 and 2 on Geary. And I just go down there and like, amazing. I just order the whole Peking duck. And then my daughter goes crazy. We just pound like a whole Peking duck. It's unbelievable.
Sounds like a great experience.
Inner Richmond is like, do you live here or you live down Palo Alto?
I live here.
You live here?
Yeah, I've always lived here.
Yeah. I think the Inner Richmond is like this hidden gem. I know people don't like it out there because of the, it's overcast, I guess, and it's like a big immigrant population. Like when I was looking to get a place here when I first moved up, the broker said to me, I don't think you want to live over here with these people.
With these people.
And I said, what people are we talking about here? He said, well, you know, it's kind of like ethnically or whatever. I was like, do you mean Asian people?
Yeah.
And he's like, well, you know.
In the Bay Area.
And I was like, my wife's Korean. Like, do not understand. Like, you're talking about my wife and my daughter is like a half, you know, Hapa kid.
Right.
He's like, well, I'm talking about like, you know, right off the boat. Like, right. And I was like, oh, you're making it even more racist and worse.
Yeah.
But the food out there is amazing.
It's pretty great. A lot of great affordable selection.
Amazing stuff out there. Like, and I think that's going to be the next hip place. Like, so you got Burmese Superstar on those kind
Burmese
of places.
Superstar, yeah.
Amazing.
Burmese Superstar.
There's a new place out there. I think it's called Waco. It's a sushi place.
It's a sushi place, yeah.
It's like going to Matsuhisa. You know, it's like $9 a piece, $8 a piece, but it is like going to Jubaku in New York or, you know, Masa in when it was in LA, like, or Matsuhisa, Nobu's original place in LA. It's like really, really well done. Have you been there?
I've been there once, yes, walking. Yeah.
Oh my God.
It's fantastic. I mean, you've really discovered the eats in the city, Jason, I must say. Like,
I'm a foodie.
I can tell. I was like,
I'm always like trying to get the recommendations.
You know where to go.
Inner Richmond.
I mean, there's actually not that many merchants in San Francisco, believe it or not, per square foot, or even per, you know, capita, you know, relative to
the
New
number
York
of people. Well, you know, and the interesting thing about here is getting a reservation here. I mean, I know it's boomtown.
Yeah.
But if you want to go out in San Francisco, you better use reserve. Like,
you gotta book
full disclosure,
ahead.
I'm an investor, but like
you got to book ahead.
You have to book ahead, or you're just not going to get this place. And this is an egalitarian place. I don't know if in New York I could tip people off at the maitre d'. We'll take a tip. You try to tip somebody here, they're a little bit like, ah, it's not New York. They don't really want you to give them $20 on the way in to get a table.
Right.
They're like, yeah, no, there's no reservation. You can't buy your way in here. Like,
yeah.
Really? The maitre d's don't take tips.
Not even for you, Jason.
I tried it a couple times out here. People, it didn't work. In New York, literally works 9 out of 10 times. You want to know my technique?
What's your
technique? Get a table at any restaurant, literally 9 out of 10 times, I should say. This is my technique. You walk up to the maitre d', you fold the 20 in your hand.
Yeah.
Very important you fold the 20, nobody sees it.
Right.
Depending on the restaurant, it might be a 50. You might have to go 50. You walk right up to the maitre d'. If there's like 5 or 6 people milling about, Doesn't matter.
Okay.
You just cut the line.
Right.
Go right to the front. You walk to the side of the desk.
Yeah.
You say, I'm really sorry to interrupt you. And you put the money on the table. You move your hand over so they can see it. You say, I'm really made a mistake. I forgot to book a reservation, but I'm with my wife, or I've got my girlfriend with me.
Right.
If there's any way you could accommodate us, I'll definitely make a reservation last time, but I made a huge mistake. If you can help me in any way, I totally appreciate it. I'm going to be over at the bar having a drink. And then I walk away. Every time, literally every time. Because what people forget is 24 out of 25 people do not tip. 90% of people, 95% of people have never tipped a maitre d'. Have you ever tipped a maitre d'?
I haven't. That's
okay, perfect. So you're the guy who's helping me out in this situation.
Yeah. I might not be able to afford the types of tips that you may be able to afford.
$20 you could afford. Come on, you got a unicorn. $20 is not a lot for you. You can do $20 if you needed to get a table, right? So you just, that's the way you do it. See, the trick here is you can't make it feel like you're buying them off.
Right.
Nobody wants to feel like you're buying them off. That's why it's so critical.
There's
you say,
reveal,
you, I made a mistake.
Cool. Right.
I'm so sorry.
Right.
And I'm looking at the book.
Yes.
So the people behind me in line think I'm pointing at my name.
Think that you have a reservation.
I'm pointing at the $20 and the $50.
Right.
So when I put my hand down, I'm saying that. And the one time it didn't work at Asia to Cuba, it was a mob scene in New York. And I had a hot date and I was trying to get in at the last minute. And it was, it was Asia to Cuba like in the 90s. It was like a hard ticket. The woman literally came to me, the model at the front desk, like maitre d' hostess came and said, I would totally take care of you. I'm sorry, but let me get you two seats at the bar. I cannot take the money from you. I'm sorry, but it's very generous of you. And she put the $20 back in my hand. She must have just felt pity for me or whatever. And she literally got me two seats at the bar, but she couldn't get me a table.
That's good service.
Well, here's the thing. People don't forget it's a service industry. You got to get tipped. What percentage of people tip on DoorDash?
Actually, almost everyone.
Really?
Yeah, really.
Do you do a percentage or a dollar amount? Ooh. And what's the proper percentage? This is a big debate amongst my friends.
Really?
Yeah, because some people feel like you should just give a certain dollar amount.
Okay.
Other people think you should tip on the delivery. Which is it?
So we default to a percentage.
Okay.
People actually have changed it higher than what we defaulted it to.
Okay. What's the default?
10.
10%. So if you go to a restaurant, it should be 22 or 20,
I, well,
25.
I don't know. Sure. I think, probably 20. Depends on the restaurant. It's fine. But no, and sometimes people will change when we allow people to customize their tip to a dollar amount or whatever it might be.
Right.
But no, people actually surprise us and actually change the number.
All right. If I do a $200 order, this is where the discussion comes in. So if I'm ordering for the poker game, it's a $200.
Right.
This is where we had a big debate.
Okay.
$200 order from DoorDash.
Right.
The guy, the dasher's getting $5. Do we give 10%, $20, or do we put in a dollar amount and say, it's $10. It's pretty good for 20 minutes of work or a half hour or whatever it is. They're going to make $30 that hour.
Yeah.
So even though it's only 5%, it's $10. On a relative basis, it's $10. What should you do?
How many people are eating? How many people are
Six
playing?
Six or seven people playing the game.
A couple bucks per person, right?
$3 or $4 per person.
Or a couple bucks even.
$2, $3 per person is $12. So that would be under the 10%. It would be like more like 5% on a $200 thing. All right. That's your answer. What would you do?
$200? I've always been a generous tipper.
Because you grew up in the restaurant.
Because I grew up in the restaurant.
And that's the right answer.
So for me, I can't speak about your poker player buddies, but now for me, exactly. I grew up seeing, my mom's, through the struggle. And so, no, I'm a very generous tipper.
And you know what I did to this one guy who would do not a big tip?
What did you do?
Person came with the bill. He was in a hand. He said, can you sign for me? I went. It was $140. I gave a $50 tip.
Wow.
I brought it back. I handed my friend the receipt.
Wow.
I said, this is how you tip. He looked at it. He goes, you tipped $50? It was my card. I tipped $50 on his card because he's such a cheapskate. It was awesome.
Well done. Well played.
Well, I mean, you can't be playing.
Hopefully you won the poker game too.
Whatever. You're up and down. You're up and down. But anyway, I just think like it's a very interesting thing on the tipping because percentage-wise on a big order, it might be too much. Percentage-wise on a small order, if you're doing like a $20 order or a $25 order, 10% not enough. It's $250. You should change it to $5.
Yes. That is what I do.
That's what I do because I'm like, hey, listen, it's 10% on a $25 or $30 order. It's $2 or $3. It should really be $5 or $6.
Yeah.
I mean, give the guy a break or a gal a break. And then, if it's $250, well, if you're a baller dude and you're playing in a poker game, like, don't be cheap. Like, this, here's how I explain it to people with tipping.
Sure.
There's no difference for you as a person working in the technology industry to give a $15 tip or a $20 tip or a $15 tip and a $25 tip. It's not going to have any impact on your life. You'll get your credit card statement at the end of the month, at the end of the year, whatever you spent on food. If you spent $5,000 this year or $5,200 or $6,000 or $6,400, it makes no difference to you.
Right.
It makes a huge difference to the person who's delivering your damn food and who works at that restaurant. It's a huge difference for them if they're, you know, month to month on their rent or whatever, like you and I were.
Yeah.
And they probably were. Ugh. Makes me crazy, bad tippers.
Well, it sounds like you have a great policy. I would just stick with it.
My policy has gotten ridiculous. You know what I did? I'm a member of a private club.
Okay.
And I can't say the name of it because I don't like to talk about the private club, but right. We're in San Francisco.
Well, it's private, yeah.
It's private. Anyway, they let you put your tip amount in.
Okay.
In the percentages. Now, I'm a very big tipper now.
Right.
So I put like 40% as my standard tip.
Wow.
That's a huge tip.
That's a large anyway, tip, yes.
But for me, it's not like that big of a deal now where I am in life. It's, you know, if I buy a $100 dinner, if I give a $20 or $40 tip, I want to, you know, I'm at the club twice a week. I like to give a big tip. It all works out in the end. My friend is at the club. He orders scotches for the table.
Right.
He says to me, can I put it on your membership? My friend's like not doing great or whatever. I said, okay. Or he says, hey, do you want to get this round? I said, sure, I'll get the round. He orders Macallan 25 double shots. He orders five of them. Do you know what a Macallan 25 is in a private club?
I don't know how much it costs at the club.
About sure it's marked up. $50, $60 thing. So a double is $100.
Yeah.
It's a $400 check of scotch. And like an idiot, I have a 40% tip by default. I get my email. It's a $600 in scotch. I was about to go mental.
Hopefully the scotch was worth it.
It was not worth it. It's idiotic. But my friend, I had no idea my friend would do something as idiotic as order double Macallan 25s and then ask me to pay for it. Would you do something like that? Is that normal behavior? If you ask somebody if they want to buy a round and then you order the most expensive scotch on the menu and order doubles?
Probably not, but I probably wouldn't also, you know, be at the private club.
You will be. Trust me. Listen, everybody go get DoorDash. It's just such a great product. It's so well put together. It's literally, when you talk about delighting customers, it's so delightful. We order in our house. You don't know because you have like my account, but then I have a secret account now.
Got it.
That's not under my name. So you have like, you can probably see some orders under my name, but then there's like a household account that's under a pseudonym now.
Your alias,
yeah. So people have an alias thing going. So like, you probably don't see it, but there's like literally.
We don't stalk our customers, Jason.
You know what's interesting about that? When you have a recognizable last name and you're in Silicon Valley, I literally had somebody I ordered from their service.
Yeah.
And I guess they share the name with the people whose food that they're selling.
Okay.
And I literally got emailed by one of their vendors who said, hey, we saw that you ordered this. We were wondering if we could come have lunch with you.
Their company. Yeah.
So they not only did somebody at the company, one of their partners got the list of.
Wow.
So I called the CEO and I said, by the way, I'm a fan of your service. Obviously, right. I'm ordering from you. But do you give your the names of your – well, we drop ship and, you know, people – I said, you kind of got to put that in your – so then I went and I read the terms of service, and it didn't have anything in there about, like, giving my name to other people. I was like, kind of gave my home phone number, my personal – my phone number and the address. And it's like, yeah, we changed that. And I was like, by the way, you know, there's, like, ambulance driving, like, attorneys out there who look in terms of service for this kind of stuff. Like, you could wind up getting a – you got to clean up your terms of service. Like, don't just cut and paste it.
Totally.
A little bit nuts. Data breaches. You must have a ton of celebrities on DoorDash in LA.
Like I said, we don't stalk our customers.
Exactly.
We do not.
That
stalk
is interesting,
our
though. When you think about it, if you're a delivery person, and you can you imagine you're a delivery person and you zip up to the door and like
it's a dream come true.
Brad Pitt opens the door.
Imagine if you're a part-time actor, dashing with DoorDash.
You must get a complaint like that once in a while. Like the guy asked for a picture with me. No, you know what? You have. Oh, I just realized it. If you're Brad Pitt, you don't answer your own door. This is how they say, I'm an idiot. I don't know. All right, listen. Everybody go. Use DoorDash. It's an amazing product. I love it. I give it my highest endorsement. I've been using it for years. 24 cities. And if you're a developer, my advice is, if you're a developer and you're going to pick a company to go work for, you want to pick a rocket ship that you know has got like escape velocity. This is a rocket ship with escape velocity. You want to get in now before they go public or anything else happens, somebody buys them. They got their Series C. Series C is like the perfect time to join a company. Like, so I'm assuming you have some job openings.
We have a few.
Yeah, so go to like jobs.doordash.com or doordash.com/jobs. Slash jobs, it's gonna be one or the other. And hey, listen, I don't want to give Tony's email on the air, but typically the guy who's the CEO or gal is the CEO, they typically get first name at company name, so whatever.
If Tony you're like, at DoorDash.com.
Yeah, Tony at DoorDash. If you're a great developer, if you want to be part of the team that launches new cities.
Would love to hear from you.
We're love to hear from
across
you.
The board.
Hiring
feel free to email me directly.
Great company to work for, too. I hear good things, actually, about it. All right, listen, everybody go try DoorDash. Thank you to our partners. Thank you to Emmy award-winning producer Jackie for making my life easy. She gets all the great guests, including Tony Hsu. All right, we'll see you all next time. Bye-bye.